Welcome to the Surviving BPD Relationship Breakup Podcast. If someone in your life has BPD, you know how difficult it can be, and you need to learn how to heal from those toxic relationships. And that's where this show comes in. Expert education, expert knowledge, expert insight, and delivered with compassion and empathy. With your host, counselor and trauma recovery coach, AJ Mahari. To purchase and book sessions with AJ, go to ajmahari.ca. Now your host, AJ Mahari.
Borderline personality disorder, borderline tribalism, the adopting of the wokeist narrative of victimhood extraordinaire, wherein they right fight, which is cognitively distorted, unsound, and lacking logic. But they right fight. People with BPD, they right fight. People with BPD tend now to believe in this rather tribalist, wokeist narrative communication attempt to say that, ooh, everything that I've said, or maybe other people online are saying about them, and if you've been in a relationship with somebody with BPD, we're all wrong. They're all right. We just don't get them. We just don't understand them properly. We just don't give them enough. We just can't pander enough to their manipulative, lying, lack of selves, and the way that they just don't understand how they impact the people that they relate to, are in relationships with, communicate to, or ad hominem online. So there are some people with BPD that truly are more aware and won't fall into this. But wow, they seem to be fewer and further between than even I thought. So I'm going to share here a little bit about my experience and what I'm now terming borderline tribalism and what that means online. My experience and a new boundary that I've just set for myself, I share that with you and talk about other things in this podcast episode that hopefully will help you to process more about what you need to do for you and or validate a place and a realization you might be sitting with about a relationship with someone with BPD or the breakup or the limbo place or whatever's going on. And this might validate and hopefully give you strength to understand that you need to set some pretty hardcore boundaries for yourself. You need to get into a healing recovery journey, because people with BPD today are just upping their game of entitlement, of this clever obfuscation of any personal responsibility in the right-fighting narrative that they're all apparently, quote, right, unquote, and we are all wrong. So their partners are wrong, their parents are wrong, their friends are wrong, their boss is wrong. I'm definitely wrong to the borderline tribalist, wokeist victim narrative extraordinaire that involves emotional abuse, splitting, projection, projective identification, all of which they're not so aware of. They do this in relationships all the time. They do it to people online who are speaking to people like you. I'm speaking to an audience of people who have been hurt by people with BPD or NPD. I am not speaking to people with borderline personality disorder, something that I'm going to endeavor to make a whole lot clearer. But I have a new boundary about this online, and I don't know if it'll affect my work with clients or not, because I don't tell clients what to do, right? I just help clients to process things, to explore things, to work on things that will help you heal and recover, but it's not up to me to tell you ultimately what your choices are going to be. So I don't know if it will affect my work with clients at all. I doubt it, but it's going to be very different for me online. So I hope that you will give this a listen when you have time. Because, yeah, I'm sharing something here and about borderline tribalism, and I'm going to go into that in more detail. But I think I also very much bring this, what I'm sharing, about an online experience, right? Endless online experiences, 15 years on YouTube. I'll bring it back and I'll bring it into focus for you to think about what's happening interpersonally for you with somebody with BPD. Because in some ways, what I've encountered online for 28 years, on YouTube for 15, from many, many people with BPD, is different, yes, and I have different boundaries around it, now a more firmer boundary than in 28 years, and it still has similarity to what many people who just can't quite get to surviving the BPD relationship breakup, because you just quite can't get to the breakup, final breakup aspect of what you need to do to be able to turn from the on-off, limbo, revolving door, recycling relationship with a borderline, and the pain of trying to go no contact. You need to go no contact. You need to end that relationship. You need to get out, and you need to heal and recover. And hopefully, this will be informative to you, and hopefully it will also give you more validation for perhaps what you already know for yourself. The new boundary that I have to share here with people with BPD. So the new boundary after 20 years online and 15 years on YouTube is I am no longer going to engage with people with borderline personality disorder, no matter how much they claim and protest that they are so different from what I'm describing, when they approach with ad hominems, etc., in the borderline tribalist narrative of poor victim, quote, all of us with BPD, unquote, because there's still some people out there with BPD who are much more aware and way beyond that. But anybody who approaches or comments on my YouTube channel or anywhere else going forward with regard to anything that I say, I'm no longer engaging, period. It's a really much more firm boundary than I've had in 28 years. And I simply see borderlines upping the ante of the game they play online to try to vilify myself anyway. I'm sure others who talk about the reality of borderline personality disorder, for those of you that are loved ones or in any relationship type with somebody, especially untreated, with borderline personality disorder. So I'm going to make no more exceptions when they begin their comments or their feedback or their ad hominems, etc., within the borderline tribalist victim narrative. And it's not because I feel hurt by them or wounded by them. It's because I simply refuse to put up with, feel overly compassionate or empathic about anymore, this narrative that they obfuscate their personal responsibility with coming at me with things like, your title hurts all of us. You make us feel like we don't want to be here anymore. Well, what? And somebody recently said that my video, 18 seconds worth, that they could not stand. This person with BPD said it was hate speech. BPD is changing and morphing, and many, many more people are in this borderline wokeist tribalism, and I will not engage it for one more second of my time and content that is for people with somebody with BPD in their life, with codependency, with CPTSD, who've been abused and traumatized by somebody with BPD. That's what my focus is, and let me make that more clear than ever before. And I feel oh so fine with it, because I'm going to, in my own little humble way here, I don't think I'm all that, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to model for you how we need to never mind their borderline tribalist narrative, victim narratives of, oh, but you, blah, 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 blah. And it hurts all of us. Or you might hear interpersonally, it hurts me because you're this and you're that and you're the other thing. Because, ladies and gentlemen, what am I attempting to model here? It's not the reason for my boundary, but if it's a side effect, that might be positive. Is that you and your lives with these people in interpersonal relationships, you need to stop being so compassionate and so empathic. I'm feeling so sorry for borderlines. They won't take any personal responsibility and are not able to see you. You don't exist in their drama, traumas, childish tantrums, etc. So I hope that you can take something away from this that's valuable to you. And yeah, I didn't have to talk about this, but it's me laying down a gauntlet. Let them all come and try to engage me. I don't care anymore. I'm not here for people with borderline tribalism, borderline escapism, borderline obfuscation of their personal responsibility. Not for a second. You give them an inch, they will take miles or interpersonally years off your life. Enough with the borderline wah. But your title hurts all of us. But you make us feel like we don't want to go on. But you make us, but you. But we're right, we're just, you know, hey, they're right fighting. And they're always right, they think, oh, so inaccurately. And we're always wrong, and we're always doing it to them, right? No, ladies and gentlemen, I'm totally over it. If I still have any clients that come to me with BPD, well, that's one thing that's different. Because usually when they come, they're very aware and they're beyond this tribalist narrative of utter, ridiculous, tantrum childlike nonsense. And there are people that will watch my channel and or listen to the podcast, you never know, that will be way beyond this. So, you know, I may engage those people, but I will certainly know the difference. But hey, fool me once, fool me twice. I give too much, and I don't know if that's still latent codependency on my part, but borderlines are going to get starved around my content. And they can be as unhappy as they want to be, and they can say whatever they want. They don't have to listen to me. In fact, I'd prefer they didn't. And they don't have to agree with me, but they can keep their friggin' borderline tribalist wah, wokest wah, out of my areas online, because I will insist on that and have the commensurate boundaries to be in that no contact position with the borderlines that fit what I just described. Are you ready yet to do what you need to do for you and your interpersonal relationships or relationship and life? Because I'm doing what I need to do for me online. And I haven't even been that affected. I just no longer wait and die to want to waste another moment of my empathy or compassion on the borderline tribalist victimhood narrative people that come by and tell me that my speech is hate speech because, oh, I just don't get them or something. Excuse me. I'm a lightning rod to so many of them because they know I know what I know. And they know that I know where they live under all their excuses and their wah narratives and their victim wokest borderline tribalist claptrap. Borderline tribalism. And what do I mean by that? Well, it's interesting that having a YouTube channel for 15 years, I've had many people over the course of that time, one at a time, with BPD, come along to this video or that video or the other video that I've done on my YouTube channel and whine and complain about this, that, and the other thing, essentially. And what they usually do, people with BPD, not all people with BPD are the same, though, but what they usually do is they either try to be civil and they proclaim that, you know, they're not at all anything like what I described in whatever video. And then they also will say things like, you know, well, when you use this title or that title, it hurts me, even though I'm really much more healed and recovered. And these people, you know, tend to go to videos of mine commonly like about favorite person and people BPD can't love or attach. And I talk about they don't love or attach the favorite person either. And so they do this and they claim they're oh so different, but they start off with saying, I have BPD, but I can love, and I've had this much treatment or that much treatment, or they don't say anything about treatment. And the ones who don't usually say anything about treatment are the ones that are very abusive, right? Just categorically ad hominem after ad hominem. And really, they don't seem, most people with BPD, to have the ability to just disagree with information, leave it alone, or if you're going to talk to the person who created the content, then, or, you know, respond back, they don't respond back with what is it about it that they don't agree with, because they're free to not agree. So what they do instead of actually trying to have, they're not capable of having conversations, whether that's online, leaving comments on a YouTube channel, or not. So anyway, this podcast isn't really inspired by this. I've been thinking about this for quite a while. So I'm going to get to the borderline tribalism aspect of, you know, what I mean by that in a minute. And I just wanted to say that I was going to do this episode regardless of what happened on my YouTube channel in the last couple days. So interestingly enough, somebody came along on the channel, and don't worry, I'm not going to be talking much about the YouTube channel because I'm going to be focusing much more on this podcast and other podcasts that I have. And maybe I should just tell you right now, brand new podcast I'm doing now is called Surviving BPD, NPD, Family Relationships. So if you are an adult child of a person with BPD or NPD, as well as you might have had a partner, or you're still in limbo, or, you know, trying to work out the BPD relationship breakup, survive it to get to the actual breakup, to get into the healing recovery journey you need to be able to move forward in your life. Many people also have had a borderline or narcissistic parent. So I'll be talking much more about that in that podcast. So that podcast, again, is called Surviving BPD, NPD, Family Relationships. So this person came along on a video I did called something like favorite person, borderline favorite person, people with BPD don't attach or love, because they don't attach or love to a favorite person either. And a commenter on my YouTube video said that they'd been treated in treatment, that they knew how to love, that they had a favorite person, but it wasn't their only relationship. And I'm wondering, if somebody's really getting better and healing or recovering from BPD, why would they still need a favorite person? And so the commenter was saying that, you know, my content in that video, sure, not just that video, but that's what they were talking about. My content in that video was very hurtful. And even though this person apparently with BPD said, they also said in the comment, I've been working really hard in treatment, and I want to be able to live a full life. And I just feel like my efforts, I'm paraphrasing now, I just feel like my efforts are, oh, no, I think they said, I just feel like my efforts at trying to live a full life, your content is just going to make me seem and sound to people like I'm mad or not well, or I'm mean. I don't understand that, but that's what they said, something like that. And then they went on to say that we can all get treatment, meaning BPD. So again, another person with borderline personality disorder in this borderline tribalism that's likely unconscious and not organized, or could be conscious, but it's not an organized tribalism, so to speak. Might be in some places online, but I don't think overall. So this person then said, you know, that they were in treatment, they could love, they could commit. Ironically enough, they didn't mention anything about personal responsibility, but, you know, who knows? I did a video in response to this commenter's comment. Oh, they also asked me to please not use the title that I had for the video. And they said, "This hurts." But they said they were so treated and they were so able to love and doing so much better in their life. Gotta wonder. So then they said, well, you know, we can all get treatment and we can all learn to manage our symptoms. Well, I guess that's technically possible. People do it, right? But most people with BPD aren't seeking treatment. Most people with BPD aren't learning how to manage their symptoms. Then I'll have another podcast episode coming soon about what does some of this DBT treatment really mean for a relationship? What does learning symptom management for more people than not with BPD really mean about, are they really healthy in relationships now? Because I think the answer is no. They're still, they might do better, but they're still going to be having triggered emotional dysregulation. They're going to have to do this in a very artificial way. So I would still say, what is treated enough? What is recovered? What is healed and recovered that would make somebody able to actually be in a healthy relationship, seeing the other person, be mutual, reciprocal, etc.? The answer is, that takes a lot of work, and more work than I think I've heard anyone with BPD, or most people, I shouldn't say not anyone, on my YouTube channel sharing things. I'm just going to say here, I shouldn't really say this, but I'm no longer going to be replying to people with BPD unless they're astoundingly different from the usual. Some aren't abusive, some are civil, some are, you know, ad hominem after ad hominem. The borderline tribalism, they feel right and everyone else is wrong. So if you had a conversation with a person with borderline personality disorder, no matter where they claim to be, no matter what they say about their treatment or where they're at with things or if they're in treatment, or so many people with BPD, you know, they'll tell a partner, I'm going to go to therapy, and they'll go to therapy. But then the partner realizes over years sometimes it, you know, like they think that the person is working on things and things will eventually someday get better and we can keep this relationship going. And in the meantime, so many people who have been a significant other of so many people with BPD, nothing really changes. You continue to get really hurt. And you wonder, well, when am I going to see the fruits of this person's therapy and treatment? Well, you know, so often, and I would say probably largely for a majority of people with BPD, and more often than not, but not always, they're not even, they might be going to see a therapist, but they're not working for the most helpful healing kinds of therapeutic modalities. Many people with BPD will have a therapist for years, but they're not really talking about BPD. Or maybe they haven't been diagnosed and they're just like complaining about you, the partner, and you are the quote bad guy, unquote. And so they're just getting all of whatever they say from their one side of everything, or black and white, you know, whichever side, the black side they're probably on. When they're talking to a therapist and complaining about you, they're not talking about themselves. I mean, so many. I've heard this over and over from clients, too. So be wary. If you're staying in a relationship because your partner with BPD is in therapy, like, because for so many people that I've worked with, that's turned out to mean nothing, because even DBT therapy doesn't work for everybody. But a lot of people with BPD are talking to therapists that just validate them. Might not specialize in BPD. And if a person with BPD is talking to even a really skilled therapist, if they don't want to change, they're going to find ways around that. They're going to make the process what they need it to be. And then they won't get anywhere. What do I mean by borderline tribalism? Well, it's how they come along. And I've been online for 28 years, right? So I don't remember YouTube started in 2005 and I started in 2008, but I wasn't always making videos or whatever, like through the whole time. Borderline tribalism, I think I noticed it, not in the way that it presents now, but these people with BPD, they come along one at a time, and whatever they're saying, whether it's ad hominem and abusive, or whether it's like put in civil language, it's still kind of the same entitled manipulation, because they're trying to say, at least it's been my experience, so they're trying to say to me, for example, as I believe they probably say to other people, I don't know, I'm somewhat of a lightning rod with this stuff in a lot of cases, but that might be because I've tried to show people with BPD some compassion and kindness, even on my channel, etc., and maybe that's the no good deed that I do that cannot go unpunished, because other channels on YouTube, other places online, just vilify borderlines as monsters and don't want to hear anything different. And a lot of people feel that way after you've been really hurt and traumatized by somebody with BPD. I have tended not to do that. I don't think that's what I want to do now. However, I think I'm definitely done with conversations with borderlines online, because the same thing happens all the time. No matter how they present, they start to complain and whine or argue or fight about what my content is, and then why it's all wrong or whatever, and they make their points, but more than make their points, they usually take their shots, right? And so then I don't know what that's supposed to accomplish. And the thing about that is, this is what I mean by BPD tribalism. One after the other, they come along in various different ways of communicating or not communicating, etc. And then, but they're always saying, but you said this, and this makes us feel. And, you know, if you're saying this, or you're using that title, oh, well, you know, quote, I've been so treated for my BPD that I can make a commitment, and I can love, so, unquote, so somebody said recently on the YouTube channel. And then, but like, your title hurts us. They don't say, your title hurts me, which would make much more sense, but they say, your title hurts us. This is borderline tribalism, because even if they're not organized, and I believe there is some organized borderline tribalism online in many areas on the internet, I've fallen into a few of those rabbit holes, where they really have their own narrative, and it's not that correct, and they definitely validate each other somehow before they start arguing with each other, of course, and nobody can really be held accountable, but, you know, they are the, quote, us of the borderline tribalism that's going to go against the them, which is everybody else, or someone like myself or many other people who try to help educate and help others who've been in these relationships with many people with BPD that, you know, the relationships aren't possible. You get so hurt, you don't get seen, you don't get heard. And when it comes time that you have a feeling or you need something or you want something from the partner that you've been giving everything to, often in a codependent, externalizing out, rescuing kind of fashion, well, when you need something or you want something, they're nowhere to be found. There's no mutuality or reciprocity in this deal. Borderline's like, you know, I had one say to me recently in a comment, like, well, I've heard this many times. What you said in whatever video, it makes us want to take our lives. Like, this is just crazy stuff, because nobody has the power to make anybody do any such thing. And of course, I'm not encouraging people to do that. I'm not even usually talking about that. So there's that. And then there's a person recently on the YouTube channel, a borderline, that again, you know, said they're in treatment and they're on meds. So I guess maybe they think that they're all right. All of a sudden, in that right fighting way that people with BPD have, kind of like, I don't know, communicating to people in an entitled, manipulative, and abusive way. And so there was this guy out there, and his comment was, you know, whatever. And then when I deleted the comment from my YouTube channel, he emailed me through my website to tell me that I had my video. He reported my video. He reported for hate speech. He reported my website for hate speech to who I don't know. But and then when I just responded back to one email, like he said a bunch of stuff and I just said, you're entitled to your opinion. Goodbye. And then another email came. It was more to say, yeah, they never felt so disrespected in 42 years of their life is what I said in some video that had nothing to do. I think it was the one that borderlines can't, won't, and don't love and attach. Won't love you and don't attach to you. Something like that. The title. And so this was a 42-year-old borderline who had never felt so disrespected in their entire life as they were in the first 18 seconds of that video of mine. Well, you know, they can feel that way. It doesn't matter to me. That's fine. I don't take it personally. But the tribalism aspect, again, is what you're saying here, I'm paraphrasing, but they said this in a specific way with ad hominems, etc. What you're saying here, you know, makes me not want to even continue with therapy. Why should I bother? Because you just make me want to unalive myself. There's no logic in that. That's not reality. So this is what I'm talking about, borderline tribalism. And most recently, the commenter that came along to my YouTube channel to, I don't care if you reported me like all over the world, whatever. I haven't done anything that violates terms and services on YouTube or whatever. So, and I don't have hate speech. So anyway, not, you know, but that is so wokeist. And this is where the BPD tribalism comes in. That they are like this tribe that's not connected to each other. Maybe some organization in some areas on the internet. But essentially, for some reason, which could be more a narrative that they talk to each other about in different places online. But for some reason, they do come, I've experienced them coming at me, with very similar statements about, oh, well, since you said this, why should I even bother trying to get any treatment? Since you said that, then I must just be a piece of, you know, since you said this, I want to unlive myself. So it's like they wildly take things personally, right? Obviously. And then they just get triggered to emotional dysregulation and nothing after that makes any sense. And that's where you, if you're the partner, you're still relating to somebody with BPD, and especially untreated, but not like way successfully, significantly treated. It's hard to say that because it's so vague sounding. And a lot of people with BPD might step up and seem like they're in that sort of treated place that I'm referring to, but they're not really, more often than not. So these people with BPD, they right fight with no personal insight into who they are. Or who you are. Or in the case of talking to me online, they have no clue who I am, what I know, what my experience is or not. Nor do they care, because it's all about them. They right fight to obfuscate ever doing the work necessary in treatment, even if they're trying to report that they've done that work. Kind of shows in their comments, reflecting borderline tribalism, you can't say that about us. You're wrong. We're not like that at all. What do you mean we don't love? What do you mean we don't attach? I love and I attach, says each one of them. Meaningless, actually. Borderline tribalist wokeism, the poor me, becomes each borderline individually expressing that, but saying something in a way that implies, quote, poor us, unquote. Meaning all people with BPD. Poor them. What about them? Them, all day long. Them. It's all the borderline tribe versus everyone else. While so many with BPD think symptom management means that they can actually love, be loyal, and attach to someone. No, they can't, they won't, and they don't attach. And they don't understand loyalty or respect or even common decency in relating to partners or others. They wound their children and they eternally punish their parents. Not only do they wound their partners, their friends, their favorite people, people in general, but they really won't attach or love partners. They wound their children. They use their children as pawns in custody wars, and they parentally alienate the other parent from their children. They don't care about the children. They're just thinking about themselves and the eternal war of how they have to be right. And everything, nothing's wrong with them. Everything's wrong with a partner who they have the children with in that case. And they eternally punish their parents. And you know, I'm somebody who had a borderline narcissist mother, really strongly in the covert narcissist area. And a father who was a malignant narcissist, dark triad, psychopathic dark triad. And, you know, I had a lot of work to do from the trauma of my childhood, but I healed from it and I let it go. And, you know, even I, and I don't mean even I like I'm important or anything, just even in my experience of a tremendous amount of abuse in my childhood, narcissistic abuse, sexual abuse, physical abuse, emotional abuse, all kinds of things, neglect, you name it. Well, I'm sure there's people who had it worse than me too, by the way, but I'm just saying, in my own experience, I didn't even eternally punish my parents. I couldn't wait to get away from them. And then in therapy, somewhere in my mid-20s, I definitely went no contact from the entire kit and caboodle of my family of origin, thank you very much, cluster B riddled as it was. But, you know, it's in the past. People with BP that are not healed or recovered or not doing as well as they think they are, though they might be doing better at times, they will eternally punish their parents one way or the other. Whether they're constantly seeking them or punishing them, you know, keeping them away from grandchildren, not seeing them, whatever. And they often are enmeshed with the parents, and that's really unhealthy. Because then they're constantly pursuing, no matter how old they are, they could be 45, 50, 60 years old, still pursuing a borderline or narcissistic parent, trying to get what they never did get. So, what's up with that? Because that's pretty much self-defeating behavior and trying to relate that way. Borderlines betray and wound anyone who gets close to them. At the rate that people with BPD lie, manipulate, and feel entitled, it's just astronomical, really, and how deep that goes inside of them. And the whys and the wherefores probably don't matter that much to people who've been really hurt by them. They really don't love or attach to you. There may be times when it seems that way, or it's a bit that way, but in any consistent, congruent, age-appropriate way, no. It's always this fragmented, maybe momentary or a few hours or a couple of days kind of experience till they split you to devaluation again because of the approach avoidance conflict. And by the way, I don't even know how DBT speaks to healing the approach avoidance conflict, which is the core of splitting, the splitting defense. Because a person doesn't have a sense of self, doesn't know who they are, can't trust others, doesn't trust self or know self, the approach avoidance conflict rises up from the arrested emotional development by or before the age of 2 for people that will go on to be diagnosed with BPD. It rises up before people in their second year of life can experience separation individuation. That's like at the core of what's going on and people with BPD having this approach avoidance conflict. And so splitting is that major defense mechanism against how they can't really be close, can't stay close, and they can't stand a little distance because, well, a little distance means you've abandoned them, and a little too much closeness, whatever they deem that to be, well, that's engulfment, and then they feel controlled. So it's an utter no-win situation. When they split you to black or to a devaluation, to a discard or ghosting or a discard that you don't know if this is the final discard, who are you when they are done? When they've split you to black and they treat you like you are their wounding parent or a wounding parent from their past, who are you? How much are you seen or heard? No, You're not. You're not attached to. You're not loved. You are being abused and not even for who you are or what you did. Borderlines need to wake up and realize how they themselves perpetuate the stigma that they're always whining about. So many whine about this in the BPD tribalism narrative. They can't get along with anyone in their lives. They can't resolve the approach avoidance conflict. Borderlines don't know themselves and can't even get along with each other for that long or anyone else. In saying anything that most borderlines don't agree with, people revealing the way they wound others without caring at all because they're still emotional children, sees them right fight against you. So that's kind of going to what I stated earlier in my experience and many years online. I think I've been very patient and very compassionate and extremely tolerant. And not that I'm going to be dispassionate, but going forward, I'm not really going to engage with these people in any way, shape, or form anymore or do any kind of content to try to reach them whatsoever, because in the aggregate of it all, I've just experienced the borderline tribalism and continue to experience the fact that there is no way to actually have a conversation with them, which doesn't surprise me. Because it's like in real life, right? You get into that Jade or you get into the Darvo and they just don't hear you. Well, they don't hear me either. It doesn't shock me. So I'm going to stop wasting my time on that front. It's not really worth it. Unfortunately, there are some people out there that may really be further along the road and have BPD and etc., but it's not my focus. My focus is on people that are hurt by people with BPD. And I'm going to pretty much just stick to that. And when they come along with their, but you know, you said this and this makes all of us feel that. No, I'm not going to engage borderline tribalism in a wokeist mentality that's ever increasing for people with BPD. Many of them who are never going to seek treatment. And of course, that doesn't matter to me because I'm usually having any interaction with them online. But I'm changing that boundary. Have you thought about changing that boundary in your life yet? Because are you hurt enough? I'm not hurt by these people online, but I am frustrated enough. I am fed up enough. And I know that it's useless for me to try to say anything that people with BPD are going to agree with, especially untreated. And I'm not that I've ever set out to do that, but I'm not going to defend what I'm saying to them anymore, ever again. Not that I was being defensive even, but I'm not going to try to explain it to have those conversations that, because it's not in person, don't end up like the Darvo or the Jade, but there's a different feel of the ad hominem, ad infinitum. So what's the point? So people with BPD, they're sticking up for each other online in pseudo disingenuous ways. I mean, in pseudo ways that are very disingenuous, like as if they get along. As if when a borderline has said to me, and I want to speak from my experience, when they've said to me online or in commenting on the YouTube channel, when they've said, well, you know, because you said this, now I feel like I don't want to be here anymore. And they stick up for each other, like all of us feel this because you said that. In my experience online, well, that's just, I don't know, pseudo-something or other, and transference and projection, and who do I become for them in their triggered emotional dysregulation? And then it's still, they think they have the entitlement to be manipulative in their communication, to ad hominem, to abuse. So they stick up for each other, supposedly, in this us narrative they use, like, your content, I'm just using this like you know what this is like in person. They'll say like a piece of my content or whatever I said is whatever to all of us. That's how it seems like they're trying to stick up for each other in borderline tribalism. But it's a really disingenuous thing because borderlines really can't get along with other borderlines much better or for that long really than they can other people in general. Borderlines don't often speak in the first person, and that's because they don't know who they are. And when they don't like something that anyone has said, they swoop in and give the borderline tribalist response. And here's just a few examples. I've given you some, but you are hurting all of us. You make us feel horrible. You make us want to not be here. Why do you say this? Why do you say that? This isn't true. That isn't true. Your title, please don't use this title. Your title hurts us. The person that said I was using hate speech, apparently my speech is hate speech to them. And they felt so disrespected and everything. I don't even know who they are. But they listened to 18 seconds of a video and essentially got triggered to emotional dysregulation and for a time lost their mind. And I'm supposed to communicate with that because that's reasonable. Why? And they were, oh, the S of this and the S of that, borderline tribalism. You, and everyone else in the borderline narrative that they rail back at you in your interpersonal trying to love them. They rail back at you like a poisonous snake. Just as borderlines continue to manipulate with incredible increasing entitlement that everyone is somehow wrong about them and misunderstanding them, will they negatively impact and wound anyone and everyone around them? And even I'm not wounded or that impacted, but they try to get me to somehow hear them in a coercive kind of emotionally abusive, verbally abusive, entitled, borderline tribalist, oh, you're hurting all of us way. And it's just another presentation of what they do interpersonally. In your relationships interpersonally, the tribalism of the borderline in your relationship is when they say to you how you did this, that, the other thing, you hurt me, you said this, you did that, and you don't know what they're talking about. And then they tell you how all their exes, who they've already told you were horrible, were all better than you. They were all fine. They treated me great. You know, what's wrong with you? That's the sort of individual relationship version of borderline tribalism. It's all you. And all these other people, they understand me, but you can't understand me. It's what's wrong with you. You're a narcissist. You're this. You're that. You didn't do this. You didn't do that. You didn't do the other thing. They get you coming and going. You don't know what they're talking about, but they will let you know endlessly how you supposedly did so much damage to poor them. That's the intimate, interpersonal, borderline tribalism at work. So this ever-increasing entitlement that's now fallen into the wokest mentality of, you know, quote, hate speech, unquote. We continue to misunderstand them. Everybody's wrong but them because, oh, they know so much about themselves. Is everyone's wrong about them, misunderstanding them. Will they negatively impact and wound anyone and everyone around them? Why isn't this part of their tribalist online narrative? Because they still lack personal responsibility and awareness, and they don't have a stable sense of self. They continually say they can love and attach. Yeah, sure, as if. How many times maybe have you been told that? How many times maybe have you recommended that the person you've been with, or maybe more than one relationship with a cluster B, how many times have you tried to explain yourself and all effort is just, it just doesn't garner anything. Nothing changes because people with BPD have to go to, you know, Dr. John Gunderson, the late Dr. John Gunderson said that therapy and recovery from BPD takes 8 to 16 years. For some people, they're just not going to get there even if they go to therapy, unfortunately. And for others, they don't go, obviously. And some are still needing diagnosis, but they have all the patterns, and it really shows. The other thing is, I think, you know, 15, 16, 20 years is more of an accurate statement. And DBT comes into this equation Not saying DBT isn't helpful for many people with BPD, but it's not a recovery modality. And they're going to be symptom managing. And so maybe some symptom manage really well, and that might impact the relationship positively. But that's not the majority of people with BPD in that therapeutic modality. And that people with BPD go to DBT for 1 year and think now they're recovered. Like, what? I don't think so. They continually say they love and attach, more borderline denial, and self-focused negating of everyone they leave in emotional tatters. But the borderline tribalist narrative, it doesn't address that at all, does it? It doesn't address how they impact others. It just addresses how they feel so hurt and wounded by friggin' everything anybody could ever say. Because they're taking it all personally, and maybe they have, you know, they don't have any emotional skin. But whose personal responsibility is that? Certainly not mine, online, and certainly not yours in any interpersonal relationship. It's their personal responsibility to figure out why they feel what they feel, what they're doing with it, and how the heck to regulate it. More borderline denial, like I said, they're self-focused, they negate everyone else, and the borderline tribalist, wokeist narrative. We aren't the way you describe. As borderline after borderline proclaims this, they are somehow so different to what we all know they truly are like. Petulant children that can't see past their own childish tantrums, demanding you be perfect for the borderline while they believe they owe you nothing. Who are you after all? They don't really know you. They don't really love you. They don't really attach to you. But you might really feel you love them. And you might have some, though it won't be secure attachment, you might have some attachment to a person with BPD. Now, you're really going to end up in a world of hurt if you don't know that already. Do borderlines deserve your empathy or your compassion after their use and abuse and betrayal of you? Which often includes infidelity in relationships. I guess that's for everyone to decide for themselves. But online, they're not really going to get that from me anymore. No more benefit of the doubt, unfortunately. Because the higher numbers of people responding to me and my content are impossible to actually converse with or respond back to, because nothing gets achieved. Absolutely nothing. They just stay in their circular, lack of logic, right-fighting, quote, arguments, unquote. And by the way, where in the borderline's sight are you, or in their life are you, or what is your worth to the borderline? Where are you in a borderline's tantrum? Is there any room or thought of you? Of course not. And I don't take personally what's been said to me online. I put up with it for 28 years. On YouTube, I've tried to do my best with each and every one of them over the time. I don't know how many borderlines that would be. And I'm drawing a boundary here and now and communicating it. And wherever it lands. Because you know what? Doesn't mean I have no compassion for people with BPD, but that's really not my focus, really not my problem, really not my responsibility. So as I continue to do podcasts, I don't know how much more I'm doing on the YouTube channel. It just seems to be a cesspool, and I'm really kind of tired of being in the dirty water. And I mean that to say of people with BPD bringing the borderline wokeist tribalist narrative now, like they didn't do several years ago, but it keeps getting worse because people with BPD often aren't getting any better. So I'm not going to waste my time there anymore is all I'm saying. So this isn't about me and that declaration or that, you know, new and changed boundary that I have. Why would I share this with you? I'm sharing it with you because just think about this. If you're still wanting that ex back, if you're still doing the on and off, if you're in the limbo place with somebody with BPD in your life, or you have a BPD parent or an NPD parent, and you're still trying to work all that out, and you're trying to fix everybody, and you are just letting yourself down, as many people with codependency are, then think about the boundary that I, you know, not that I'm a great example, I'm just saying, think about the boundary that I just set. That it took me 28 freaking years to finally go, no, that's it. It's enough. I'm not going to give the benefit of the doubt to any of these people anymore. So it took me 28 years to do that. I wasn't even being really hurt. It could be frustrating at times, but I kept trying to have the conversations, not interpersonal, right, but online with people with BPD, largely untreated. And now I do not even want to invest in the ones if they've been somewhat treated. You know, if I see somebody with super awareness, that'll be different, right? But when they're saying anything to do with the borderline wokeist tribalist narrative now, which is really just a borderline narrative of right fighting on steroids or something, on more social media, right? With more dopamine hits and finding validation somewhere from other borderlines until they start arguing with each other. So my point is, all that I'm saying about the boundary that I'm setting here online and why matters not really, but I share it with you because I could just easily just have moved into that, as I have now anyway, but just moved into that boundary without saying a word about it. But I'm sharing it here not because you're supposed to be so interested in what I've been through for 28 years with these people online, but because think about that. I'm not even talking about interpersonal relating, right? The way that so many of you have been trying and trying and trying, keep believing and hoping and wanting your relationships to work out against all hope. I could have continued online forevermore to engage these ad hominem, you know, borderline, wokeist, tribalist narratives of how dare you, and when you say this, this hurts all of us, and when you do this, it hurts all of us, and this makes all of us feel that, and why should I even try to get better from BPD if you're going to say that? Well, all of that that I've endured, put up with, tried to be compassionate about, tolerated for 28 years online, is but a drop in the bucket to what people are going through in the interpersonal reality of significant other relationships or relationship to a borderline narcissist parent or friend or neighbor or boss or coworker or, I don't know, people with codependency or and/or CPTSD, or if you don't think you have any codependency, or if you have counterdependency, which actually is on the spectrum with codependency, but even if you're more counterdependent, maybe you just think, hey, I'm fine. What is she talking about? It doesn't even matter. But I hope that in this episode, it will only validate more for you, and maybe for some people newer to this or finding me for the first time, start you to think about this more and or move people to actually take action for themselves in their lives to make the BPD relationship breakup happen. And sometimes that breakup, as I'll be talking about more in my other podcast, Surviving BPD-NPD Family Relationships, sometimes that breakup has to be that no contact has to be with a parent or an entire family of origin. And I'm considering right now doing another podcast about how we live in a cluster B world and what does that mean? Because that's a reality, ladies and gentlemen. So you need to learn, get into a healing recovery journey. You need to learn how to break the trauma bond. And you might have a trauma bond from childhood. With a parent or parents or siblings or cluster B in your family. And maybe you don't realize it. Most people do, but they just kind of tuck it away somewhere because people with more significant codependency just don't want to feel like a bad person, just don't want to feel judged, just don't want to make any waves or conflict avoidant, don't want to even think about that parent or that sibling or the neighbor or maybe a best friend for years. Well, there's really something off with them and they really don't. They're really not healthy for you to relate to, but you stick in there. And that's really at the heart of codependency. That's why I'm always talking about that. So you need to think more today, or if this is validation for you and what you already know and what you're trying to affect in your life. It's really sad and tragic to have to say this, But for the majority of people with borderline personality or narcissistic personality disorders, you really need to get out of there. You do really need to make surviving the breakup about surviving the breakup, not recycling, not being in limbo, not wanting them back, not wondering if they're coming back. Well, how can I get them? And it's really difficult. You're going to feel a lot of pain in the process. But if you reach out and work with somebody, and I'm out here to work with those that resonate with me, you can get through this. And this will become one of the most important lessons in healing, knowing yourself more, and growing forth that you could ever get into action to work through, to learn from, to grow from, and to heal from. And the opposite of that is staying on the borderline roller coaster from hell, and it doesn't really lead anywhere else but from hell to hell and back from hell and back to hell. And that's just unfortunately the way it is, because people can describe borderline personality disorder in so many ways, but along with the description should come this information. Borderline personality disorder, for all that it is sliced and diced to be, it is a relational disorder with communication deficits, cognitively distorted ways of thinking, not all that histrionic, oh, they're psychotic and they're this and they're psychopathic. It's not really about that for most people with BPD. That's a very small percentage. You know, less than 1.2% of all women diagnosed with BPD, for example, 40% of all women diagnosed, men as well, with BPD, have some NPD traits. Or they may have that comorbid picture of BPD, NPD, which actually doesn't mean anybody ever diagnoses them with two full-on personality disorders. But it does change the dynamic. So in my message, which I probably will regret having shared publicly because some borderline tribalists, wokest people are going to come along and go, oh, listen to her now, and you know, see, I always knew she didn't care about us. I always knew she hated people with BPD. I don't hate them at all. But the point is, we really have to take care of ourselves. There has to be limits and boundaries. And especially online, it was like not taking much of my energy or time, right? But in people's personal lives, it's a difference between being constantly stressed, being in constant fight-flight mode, walking on eggshells, experiencing codependency, and continually crossing those wires or the beliefs that you've grown up with, that you were inculcated with in childhood, that somehow real love that is worth fighting for with a borderline or a narcissist has all to do with how much you suffer, how hard you try to change them, and how much you just sacrifice yourself to them. And that is not love at all. Because where there is abuse of any sort, at any time, it is the absence of respect, of love, of seeing or caring about other. Because abuse is a very selfish thing that abusers do. All about them, no regard for other. And in Cluster B, this is what it all amounts to. So I don't even know what to say anymore about if the borderline is treated well enough. Because you know what? If you know, if you're in a relationship, a limbo, a revolving door situation, on, off, you're the ex who wants your borderline back, they will need 8 to 12 to 16 to 20 years if they go to the appropriate kind of methodology, modality of treatment with the world's leading experts. Primarily, that's what it's going to take for more people with BPD than not, if they'll even, you know, enter the process of treatment. And of course, many of them won't even do that. So then you have to ask yourself, what are you really trying to accomplish? What is your repetition compulsion cycle about? You're externalizing out and giving and giving and giving and caring about this borderline, and they don't take it in. They don't trust it. They don't really experience you for you. You are always going to be that, on and off at least, and often when they're triggered, you're going to be the object other parent representation of wounding parent. And so many people with BPD relate to a partner unconsciously, probably unknowingly, as if you are their parent anyway. You're supposed to be there for them, do everything for them, meet all their needs, do extra, none of which you're going to get credit for, none of which you're going to get anything given back to you for. It's a dead-end, one-way deal. It's a no-win situation. People with borderline personality disorder cannot and will not actually, in any age-appropriate, consistent, congruent way ever be able to experience you for you, see you for you, love or attach to you, no matter how much the wokest BPD tribalist narrative says out there, oh, but I can love, you know, your video. What you said there, like, that's not me. I can love. I can do this. I can do. Well, you know what? I wouldn't really know if they're telling the truth or not. But often in the way that they communicate what they say, and when they say that my title hurts them, a title hurts them, or 18 seconds of a video disrespected the heck out of them and hurts them so much that they think I'm full of hate speech and I need to be reported. It's just utterly, that's a departure. Doesn't mean they're psychotic, but it's a departure through cognitive distorted thinking. It's such a departure from what reality really is in here now, isn't it? So maybe sit down if you've never done this before. Sit down and write out wherever you are in iterations with somebody with BPD, whether it's a breakup, the on and off cycle, limbo, you still want them back. Sit down and write down, you know, what are you getting from this? What's really happening? How much are they giving to you? Can you list 10 ways that they really see you and they really hear you and they show you how much they care about you that are consistent and congruent and not just maybe come and go a little bit here and there, or that they're not just telling you what you want to hear or trying to assuage you for on a certain day because, you know, mea culpa, but they can't say they're sorry and they don't know what they did and they don't know why you feel the way you do. And the more they hurt you and the more you are hurt because you're abandoning yourself also trying to rescue, fix, and have them be okay, and the more empathy and compassion you have for them, well, be careful of that, because a lot of people have too much empathy and too much compassion for them. And guess what? That leaves you with no empathy or compassion for yourself. And what's going to be the payoff? Is the relationship going to succeed or last in any healthy or worthwhile way? No. And so people are so afraid of their own work, and people are so afraid of the pain that getting to an actual BPD or NPD breakup would bring. But if you take it one step at a time, your recovery process won't be more painful than this relationship that you may still be clinging to, wanting, longing for, missing, or actively engaging, on, off, revolving door, recycling, always just to have the same experience over and over again. And, you know, I say with great respect to you, no judgment, but doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different outcome is somebody's, quote, definition of, quote, insanity, unquote. I'm not saying you're insane, but I'm saying think about that. You keep doing the same things over and over. You give more, you give more, you try again, you try again. You want that Hoover, you recontact them. It just has to work, right? It just has to work, right? Well, no. And the more that you fight for something that you think is love, well, they're abusing you. That's not your soulmate. It's not your twin flame. It's not meant to be. That would be cognitive distorted thinking on the part of people with codependency or CPTSD or people that are in relationships with people with BPD. Because here's the other thing, and I'll just end on this note. Healthy people, and again, I'm not trying to insult you or in any way judge you. Healthy people who know themselves in a strong, concise, very vulnerable and emotional way and can esteem themselves and have self-worth in spite of flaws and failings. And because we all have flaws, we're all going to fail from time to time. Healthier people do not get into these relationships, or if they do, they get out really quick. And healthier people certainly are not going to sacrifice themselves and all that they need and want in their lives for people with BPD or NPD. So think about that, and I hope that you could hear that in the way that I mean that, not judging. I'm just trying to sort of keep it real to help you think about what the pathway might be for you to heal. So the borderline tribalist, wokeist narrative is now becoming, I think it's part of, when borderline men do this to women or borderline women do this to men, the false accusations. Hey, you're a narcissist. You're this, you're that. Which is deflective, abusive, untrue, and just their projection often. I'm not talking about the labels being necessarily projection, but they'll project what they've done to you. They'll say you did to them. Gaslighting, crazy making. And you know, I'm going to be sharing more. I'm not sure whether it be in podcast or I'm going to write about it or people might have to pay a few bucks for it. I'll share more about what's going on in your nervous system when you're entertaining constant recontact, recycling, and taking and absorbing the abuse of the borderline in the name of, quote, love, unquote, or attachment. And, you know, people that have children with people with men who have children or a lesbian partner, if they have children with a woman with BPD, then that exponentially raises up a nightmare that nobody wants to experience. And with rare exception, there are some exceptions, but those would be the people that have actually done the work that aren't part of the tribalist narrative, wokeist narrative of, well, I can love, but what you said here really hurts all of us. I can love, and I'm in treatment. They might be in treatment. And I this and I that, but like, could you please change your title? Because this really hurts. And by the way, when I did a video, the last one I will ever do, back to a borderline commenter in the last couple days, when I did that video, and I had done another video, which I've taken down for now, because I got to do the podcast, and it's going to be controversial, but it has to be separated out from my other work. Anyway, I spoke about an issue, and had nothing to do with BPD, okay? And so this person with BPD that said my title hurt them. No, not them. It hurts, quote, all of us, right? Borderline, tribalism, wokeist nonsense. So adherence to their victim mentality, right? That the rest of us just need to accommodate them. No, absolutely not. That's what wokeist reality and victimology is all about. No matter what shape or under what label it comes. Oh, when we have this, it's different from that, and therefore you need to accommodate us, and I'm not talking about general things we accommodate in life, right? You need to accommodate us extra special because we need a safe space. Because what you're saying is just wrong. When did all of a sudden the ability to agree, to disagree, go away across the board in life? Never mind borderlines. So, but this borderline that was so, your title hurts me. Could you please not use this title? But they were saying they could love and they could make commitments and but they still had a favorite person. And I'm kind of like, well, how could they be so far ahead to what they're saying they are? If they have a favorite person, if my title hurts them, if they wonder if they're not just going to be seemingly, everyone's going to think they're mean in something else they said. Because of what I said, because like this hurts all of us with BPD, she said. And so then I did a video on another topic, and then I did a response video to that person, which I thought was pretty reasonable and pretty fair, in which I really wanted to hear back from them, their feedback, a couple of my questions. Trying to dialogue in a healthy, mature way with a borderline. I know, somebody hit me in the head with a hammer. So then I did this other video, which will have to kind of remain a mystery right now. And they didn't agree with it. Okay, fine. Lots of people won't when I talk about this on another podcast I'm going to start about living in a cluster B world. And it gets into a lot of different issues going on in our world today. Some people agree with them, some people don't. That's fine that they disagreed with me. But I saw the comment earlier this morning where they were, you know, I'd asked them to dialogue back with me. And some people do and some people don't, right? I can't control that. But then this borderline wrote on the video that I had essentially responded to them and really tried to dialogue with them. Essential waste of time. They said, well, since you did the other video and I don't agree with that, I don't have any more conversation with you. Now, let me just add, what's fascinating about that? Doesn't matter to me they said that. That's fine. They can do whatever they want. But here's the thing that really caught me about that. I looked at that and went, wait a minute, what? Not because they were saying, I don't want to have any conversation with you. I don't want to. No, that's all fine. Anybody can say that anywhere online, anytime. Or, you know, I don't think people in my life say that much, but they might say, I don't have time right now. And I'm like, cool, neither do I. Let's talk later. But when this person said, oh, you know, I don't agree with what you said about that, so I don't want to have any more conversation with you, to me. It's like, it was fascinating. It was like a penultimate experience for me in just a few minutes, because the first question that came to my mind was, what? Oh, okay, disagreed with what I said about something else, totally unrelated to BPD. And I'm like, but if they can set that boundary over there, what they disagreed with me about something else, then what was all that manipulative, borderline, wokeist, tribalist narrative of, could you please change your title? This hurts. When all of a sudden, when they didn't agree with something else, it was like, I don't want to talk to you anymore, which is kind of the way people do things today, isn't it? Too often, and especially online. Like, where do you see people having conversations online very often or doing collaborations on podcasts or videos wherein they are diametrically opposed in really kind of areas of life that are hotly debated about, often different topics and such? So I just thought, what does that say about what the person with BPD was saying to me the day or two prior about your title hurts? All of us, and could you please not use that title? And because of your content, no matter how hard I try to heal, and no matter how much I can love now, they were saying, people are just going to think I'm mean, and I can't remember the other crazy, or I don't remember the other word they used. But then when they disagree about something totally unrelated, boom, they're done, they're gone, which is fine. But what does that really say about what happened prior to that? In other words, ladies and gentlemen, how bullshit was what they said prior about my title, and it hurts us all, and I'm trying to do this, and because you said that, and I can't now. Oh, I disagree with you on this other subject. I don't want to talk to you anymore, which is fine. But wow, is that night and day or what? Or did I just get split to devaluation extra special because of the topic upon away from BPD that they disagreed with me on? So, just know they're that flighty. Just know they don't know who they are. They're chameleons, so bound to their personality disorder, so bound to what it all means, so bound to the genesis of it, usually in childhood for more than not. And yet, in a heartbeat on some other subject, just totally split you and throw you away. What do you think is happening in your relationships over and over and over again? How do you think, if they don't scream it all out at you, then you'd have some idea, but you're still sitting there going like, what? Because you're hurting and you're the one getting attacked and abused and yelled and screamed at. But if they don't abuse and yell and scream at you, have the quiet borderline, and they keep it all in. Have you ever stopped to think, in a jade conversation, justify, argue, defend, and explain, which you get to do, borderline never does. You're trying to hold them accountable. They don't know what you're talking about. They might know something, but they're not going to give you like an inch. Have you ever thought about what they're actually thinking, what they might know versus what they often don't know? But is there any room for you in a borderline tantrum? Is there any room for you in a borderline's black and white way of thinking and experiencing life, like this person on my channel recently? I think it's amazing. It's been a fantastic lesson for me to even see more deeply through what I now am terming. I'm going to talk a lot more about the BPD tribalism and the wokeist narrative that they are adopting now. just like so many other, quote, co-opted social justice, unquote, movements and what they're trying to do. Because, you know, we live in a complicated cluster B world. But aside from that, people, when we can carve out our own freedom and space from, you know, the censorship and the way they're getting us to self-censor ourselves and etc., I don't know how else to describe it, but I thought it was friggin' hilarious that this person that wanted to go, you know, into this wham, wokeist, borderline, tribalist narrative with me over what I said about favorite people and how people with BPD don't attach to them or love them. And that was somehow going to be a conversation that they were going to engage me in and kind of like, you know, manipulate and feel entitled to right fight me about in their own way. But oh, when something else came up they disagreed with, boom, split, gone. Split to devaluation entirely. So what are they? They're not all the same, but what are they doing when they're still basically leading you on with every Hoover or reverse Hoover and telling you what you want to hear after every episode that you go through with that person that you might still be in a relationship with or want back or etc., revolving on and off with? Really just think about it for a minute that they're just playing with you. They're using you and they're playing with you, whether it's conscious or unconscious. They need what they need and they want what they want. And so they will look to you for that. But the second that they don't like something else, like in the case of the commenter on my channel recently, "Ooh, I disagree with you on this topic. I don't want to have any more conversation with you." Well, why couldn't they have said that about what I said about BPD? I mean, I don't know why comment to say that, but why couldn't their comment instead of "your title hurts us all"? Why couldn't they just say, "You know what, I don't agree with you, and I'm going to listen to this channel ever again, and I don't want to talk with you or hear you"? That would make more sense, wouldn't it? So what are they doing in the spaces between why they do split into value, or they don't want to talk anymore, and they kind of know that, some of them, which is fine for me online, right? But what are they doing in those spaces and places so numerous that you can't count them in interpersonal relationships where there's no room for you? Because they're defending, they're splitting, they're manipulating, they're lying, they are dancing as fast as they can. And they're always right and you're always wrong. No, they think they're always right. They're not right and you're not wrong. But what about you in all this? And I'll say it again. Where is the space for you amid their tantrums? Whether in interpersonal relationships it ever gets to a point where, and think about this too, does it get to the point where you're hearing a borderline tribalist, wokeist narrative in an interpersonal way? Have you ever thought about that before? This has been a slowly but steadily, increasingly expanding reality of borderline wokeist tribalism. Essentially, they've adapted wokeism for their victimhood. And in that narrative, yes, because the other commenter that I mentioned earlier, sorry, this is a little bit out of order, not only told me that my speech was hate speech, but said that he had a disability. And why was I saying all this stuff to hurt everybody with BPD who has a disability? It's such hate speech. And he felt so disrespected. And then the other one, my title was, you know, she said the title, it might have been a he, I don't know. They said the title hurts us all. What are we to do for these people? What are you supposed to do for these people in your life? Utterly lay down your life so they can walk over you and go, "See, aha, I told you I was right"? Well, they're not right. They right fight. They wear people down. They stress you out so much. I'm going to have more coming on what's actually happening to your body. I've had clients explain in detail to me major, major, not only emotional breakdowns after these relationships are in them and they have to get out, but unbelievable effects on their body. Illnesses, things breaking down physically as well as emotionally. You deserve to get into a healing recovery journey. You deserve so much more. And so the question today is, what's blocking you from setting the ultimate boundary? And I know that what I do out here and what I take, and I'll be taking a lot more of it when I refuse to even engage any of it from people with BPD. But that's a different thing. And I have boundaries and it's not interpersonal relationship, etc. How do you think you can keep maintaining what you're doing if you're still going back, still wanting them back, etc.? Borderline wokeist narratives, borderline tribalism is upon us. I wonder, what do you think? Can you conceptualize what that might look like in interpersonal relating? Because I know what it looks like online. So anyway, I hope you found this thought-provoking, and I hope that it might be helpful, or part of it might have been validating for what you know you're experiencing and that you need to leave, or that you are not in contact, but you're fighting to want to be in contact. It's because of woundedness in your childhood, to one degree or another, whether you had a cluster B parent or parents or not, that you continue to give the borderline in your life so much power. Power that they can't handle. That means you trusting them, you loving them. Power that they don't deserve, because underneath everything emotionally, they are tantruming, petulant children.
You've been listening to the Surviving BPD Relationship Breakup Podcast with your host, counselor and trauma recovery coach, AJ Mahari. For more or get sessions with AJ, go to ajmahari.ca. See you next time.